Thank you. Before we move on to the next item of business, I'll just take this opportunity to alert members to the fact that business is running approximately 20 minutes late. The next item of business is a statement by Jenny Gilruth on mobile phones and behaviour and relationships in school. The Cabinet Secretary will take questions at the end of her statement, and so there should be no interventions or interruptions. And I call on Jenny Gilruth up to 10 minutes, Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I'm pleased to update Parliament on the Scottish Government's new guidance on mobile phones in schools and on our joint relationships and behaviour action plan with COSLA. And I know this topic is of great interest to colleagues from across the chamber and to their constituents. When we last debated this topic back in March, I said then that all of us are striving for our schools and our classrooms to be free from violence and disruption so that our young people can learn and our teaching staff can work safely. And in recognition of this shared aspiration, in April, I held a very constructive meeting with education spokespeople from opposition parties to discuss our work on relationships and behaviour and to provide them with the opportunity to feed in their priorities to the action plan. Presiding Officer, I want to begin by reminding colleagues of the key findings from the Behaviour in Scottish Schools research, which we published in November of last year. This was externally commissioned research from almost 4,000 school staff from all across Scotland. And the research provides a nationally representative picture of what is happening in our schools. And while, of course, there will be local variations, it provides robust evidence upon which to base the action plan and the guidance on mobile phones. And what BISR shows, and is a key point that we shouldn't lose sight of, is that most children and young people are generally well behaved in class and around school. But I accept this research, as well as the evidence gathered by our teaching unions and through the series of relationships and behaviour summits I chaired last year, also tells us that behaviour is absolutely not where it should be, and that post-pandemic, things have become much more challenging in our classrooms for a range of different reasons. With this in mind, I wish to begin with the development of the refreshed guidance on mobile phone use. Recently, I've been reading The Anxious Generation by social psychologist Jonathan Haidt, which highlights the broad impact that increased access to smartphones, screens and social media is having on young people. The impacts that he highlights, such as mental health, addiction and sleep deprivation, are all factors which impact on young people's readiness to learn. And it is clear from BISR, but also from PISA, that mobile phones are having a substantial impact in our classrooms, disrupting learning and often causing conflict. When I launched the mobile phone guidance at Stonelaw High School in Rutherglen last month, I heard directly from pupils and staff about the impact mobile phones were having on their day-to-day classroom experience. Before the summer, nearly 700 pupils monitored and mined their own screen time during one period of PSE. Some of their teachers also took part in this exercise, and both pupils and teachers alike were shocked by the results. On average, every pupil received 18 notifications during that 1 hour lesson. Multiply that by the number of pupils in a class and you can see how much disruption that causes to pupils' concentration. Members will know that I do not currently have the power to ban mobile phones as Cabinet Secretary. However, the updated national guidance goes as far towards a national ban as I am currently able to by setting out the government's clear support for whole school bans. Our head teachers are empowered to take the steps that they consider appropriate to create an environment free from disruption caused by mobile phones, an environment where they are better able to focus on their learning, to actively listen to one another, and one that supports positive relationships between peers and with staff too. And if that environment is best created by banning phones in the entirety of the school estate, indeed for the entirety of the school day, then the guidance will support that action. Head teachers know their schools best, and the guidance provides them with the flexibility that works for them and their local context. At Stonelaw, for example, following engagement with pupils, parents and staff, the school has prohibited mobile phones in learning and teaching areas during learning and teaching time. This protects the learning environment whilst also respecting children and young people's personal time at breaks. Speaking to the staff and pupils, they appreciated the school taking this balanced approach. They spoke about the trust placed in them through allowing continued use of mobile phones in certain areas and at certain times. And the privilege given to them by their teachers was not something that they wanted to abuse. Fundamentally, though, they realise and recognise that for them, a successful approach required a bit of give and take and adopting a collaborative approach helped everyone approach the changes positively. I turn now to the Joint Action Plan on Relationships and Behaviour, which I also launched during my visit to Solihull High School. And I want to reiterate, as I've done every time that I've spoken on this topic in the Chamber, that our schools should be safe and consistent learning environments for all pupils and staff. But what has been clear from the engagement I've taken over the last year is that relationships and behaviour in our schools have changed since the pandemic. And while discussions in this chamber have often focused on increases in violence and aggression, we've also heard about the challenges being much more wide-ranging and complex. Schools are dealing with a wide variety of challenges that they just would not have been facing 5 or even 10 years ago. Those include children and young people who are much less mature than they would expect, with difficulties communicating their emotions and navigating social dynamics. Many are struggling with their mental health, exacerbated by the pandemic and also the stress associated with the cost of living crisis. The rise of right-wing influencers having an impact on the prevalence of misogyny towards pupils and staff. And as I have said, the prevalence of mobile phone use disrupting learning and teaching. The Behaviour Action Plan is therefore ambitious in responding to this very wide variety of concerns. It contains 20 overarching actions under 8 themes that we will take forward over the next 3 years. These actions address not only violence, but the breadth of areas identified as being priorities, and those include consequences, recording and monitoring, children and young people's well-being, attendance, and empowering staff to reinforce positive relationships and behaviour. The plan balances setting clear national direction through the provision of guidance and developing capacity through enhanced practical guidance and support for local authorities and schools delivered by organisations such as Education Scotland. And importantly, the plan is jointly owned by COSLA, given that the statutory responsibility for the delivery of education rests with our councils. The plan has been developed in collaboration with the Scottish Advisory Group for Relationships and Behaviour in Schools, which includes COSLA, ADES, Education Scotland, the EIS, NASUWT, the SSTA, Association of Heads and Deputies Scotland, School Leaders Scotland, Unison, the Deans of Education, Educational Psychologists, Respects Me and Parents' Representatives. And the value of the plan being developed by Sagrabis and all the partners I've just mentioned is that all of those partners have a role in implementing the plan. They have helped also to help shape the priorities and actions that are contained within it. Now, Sagrabis will monitor the implementation of the plan over the next 3 years, and they will adjust as necessary in light of any emerging issues, including those brought to us by the teaching profession. Now, I want to acknowledge the frustration some colleagues have felt about how long it took to publish the action plan. I had intended, of course, to publish before the summer, but having considered the advice on activity during the UK Parliament pre-election period, I took the decision to launch as soon as possible in the new school term. And I want to provide reassurance to colleagues that while we have been developing the plan, we've also continued to implement action to support schools and their staff. The new mobile guidance is an example of this, but it does not stand on its own. Rather, it supplements a suite of support announced since last November, including new funding for training of support staff in direct response to the findings of the research from BISR that staff would welcome such training, new guidance on preventing and responding to gender-based violence in schools to address emerging trends surrounding misogyny, additional data and support to help improve attendance, including guidance, professional learning, networking and exemplification launched by Education Scotland only last week, and support spearheaded by our new Chief Interim Inspector to ensure that HMI inspections help to support improvement. Now, that progress that I've set out today is not the end of the journey. We will continue to focus and to bring forward actions over the coming weeks and months. This includes the publication later this year of refreshed guidance on anti-bullying, work on consequences and additional information to enhance the understanding of S4 leavers, which has also been published this morning. Presiding Officer, the development of the Mobile Guidance and Action Plan were a collaborative effort involving many stakeholders, not just in Sagrabis, but all of those who participated in the BISR research, in the Relationships and Behaviour Summits, or who have spoken to me about their experiences in the classroom or supporting their child. I want to thank all of those who have shared their experiences with us to inform this important work. And I recognise that there are unlikely to be quick, easy fixes to addressing these challenges. Neither can nor should they be addressed by schools alone. It will take sustained effort by everyone who has a role to play to improve the situation. The willingness of all to have constructive conversations about the scale of the challenge and of the actions that are needed means I am confident that this shared commitment exists. Presiding Officer, in this spirit, I very much hope that all of us across the Chamber can support the plan and the trajectory it puts in place to improve relationships and behaviour in Scotland's schools for the benefit of our children and young people, teaching staff and our whole school communities. Presiding Officer.
Thank you. The Cabinet Secretary will now take questions on the issues raised in her statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes for questions, after which we'll move on to the next item of business. I'd be grateful if those who wish to put a question to the Cabinet Secretary were to press the request to speak buttons. And I call Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm grateful for the advanced sight of the statement. But like the guidance on mobile phones and the Behaviour Action Plan, this statement is long on words and very short on detail. To be fair, the Cabinet Secretary acknowledges that the Behaviour Action Plan has taken far too long to produce, from when the Scottish Conservatives first demanded it in spring 2023, through the various groups that opposition spokespersons were excluded from, and then the delay this summer. But she fails to mention that the EIS said, without the necessary allocation of funding and resources, the plan will become little but a wish list and a real wasted opportunity. Perhaps most worryingly, this statement and the plan provided little clarity on how it will be implemented, when, and how. So, Cabinet Secretary, three questions, please. What does your planning tell you constitutes the necessary allocation of funding and resources, and will councils and schools be given them? For the outcome set out under Theme 7, Tracking Impact and Progress, when precisely will those things be done? And finally, when will the Cabinet Secretary provide clarity on the range of approaches and consequences that are available, including exclusion, where there is no appropriate alternative?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Mr Kerr for his questions. There's quite a few different areas he covers. I'll try to respond to each in turn. First of all, I'd like to pick up a favourite topic of Mr Kerr's and of others in the Chamber, which relates to opposition spokespeople not being invited to a series of meetings that I held with the teaching profession and others who work in education. I make no apologies for that, Presiding Officer. It was really important that a safe space was created for teaching staff to share their experiences of what had happened in schools, and I don't think having other politicians in the room would have been helpful to that end. However, he also knows that I am a collegiate Cabinet Secretary, and I engage with him regularly on a range of different educational matters, which is exactly why I met with the opposition prior to the election to talk about our plans in this space. And I think, actually, Presiding Officer, broadly, particularly in relation to behaviour in schools, we have seen quite good party consensus on it. We'll maybe hear more of that in the future questions that will no doubt follow. In relation to the specifics, he asks about, I think, consequences, and he also asks about exclusion. So for his understanding, new anti-bullying guidance is going to publish by the end of this year. We did publish actually on Friday, Education Scotland published updated attendance guidance. I would also draw his attention to an infographic that Scottish Government has published today, which specifically looks at S4 leaver data. And he knows I'm very concerned about our S4s at the current time and leaver trajectories, particularly in relation to positive destinations, but also in relation to behaviour and their attendance levels. The third point I think he raised related to consequences. Again, that will publish as part of the action plan by March of next year. We're working with the Head Teachers Task Force that I established last year to develop that further. He mentioned exclusion. Again, that will feature in the update on the action plan in March. And there are further practical examples that I can give him in relation to the guidance that's published today, not least, I think, Presiding Officer, the mobile phone guidance. He made a point in relation to the EIS and also on resources. And, of course, the EIS were part of Sagribus in formulating the guidance and have broadly, I think, welcomed. I recognise the point Mr Kerr puts on resources. He also recognises that this year the Scottish Government is investing record levels in our education system. And if he wants me to invest more, then I have to ask him from where that would come. Because at the current time, we have an incoming
Cabinet Secretary
who seems to be mirroring the spending decisions of the outgoing Conservative government. That is going to impact on the resources I have at my disposal as Cabinet Secretary. But I'm sure he would be keen to work with me on this in relation to ensuring we have that additionality from the new UK government to ensure this is adequately resourced.
I'm Duncan Glancy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank the Cabinet Secretary both for bringing this issue to the Chamber today and for advance sight of her statement. The publication of this guidance, whilst long overdue, is welcome. But I do worry too that the devil will be in the detail of how it is implemented because, as the General Secretary of the EIS said, as we've heard, implementation of the national guidance will indeed need resources. So I come today with a potential solution for the Cabinet Secretary. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary then, instead of the planned redirecting of RICS funding to the Government Centre for Teacher Excellence, which most in the sector don't think is needed, indeed the EIS said at the time it would not address challenges the Cabinet Secretary has set out today and recognised in her statement, does she agree with me that the RICS money could be better spent by giving it to schools to support the implementation of the approach set out in the Behaviour in Schools plan?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for her question, and I'm glad that she also welcomes the publication of the plan. I think she is correct to say the devil will be in the detail. One of the things I was very mindful of in the development of the guidance was that it's not for government sometimes to instruct schools in relation to how they implement behaviour plans. I think we do need to trust Scotland's teaching profession. I see the member nodding in agreement. And when I visited Stonelaw High School 2 weeks ago now to launch the guidance, I spoke to the head teacher in that school about how she was implementing a mobile phone ban. She's taken a much more nuanced approach than the school I previously taught in Edinburgh, where there is, as I understand it, a more whole school ban approach. But she's taken that approach by getting the buy-in from her staff and from her pupils. And I was really struck by the way in which she'd allowed that devil in the detail, I suppose, to come into fruition in her school community. But she's also used, I think, some of the real founding principles that the National Action Plan sets out. And one of the points that was raised with me by head teachers at the Behaviour Summits was the need for government at national level to set out a clear expectation around about this issue. And that's what I've been keen to do throughout this process. She asked a question about the RICS and about the Centre for Teaching Excellence. I think it's important we don't pit funding to support the profession against funding that's needed to respond to changes in behaviour. And so I suppose my point back to her is I don't want to take funding away from supporting the teaching profession. I think actually excellent learning and teaching is really important. But I want additionality. So I know, well, I can hear the member shouting when, I think, from a sedentary position. I don't yet have clarity on the VAT that the Labour government has told us is going to flow to government from private schools. And I also don't have clarity on the 6,500 extra teachers that the Labour Party promised the rest of the UK. I presume I'm going to get consequentials. Perhaps if I had some certainty on both of those funding streams, I could give additionality to behaviour in Scotland schools.
I call Elena Whittam to be followed by Ros McCall.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary will be aware that some pupils will have unique personal circumstances that will require their phones. Can the Cabinet Secretary therefore say more about how the published guidance gives considerations to those pupils, such as our young carers, those with neurodiversities, mental health struggles or medical conditions, and who may need exemptions from school-wide mobile phone policies? Thank you.
Cabinet Secretary.
I think the member raises a really important point, and I think it also relates to the response I gave to Pam Duncan Glancy. It's important we don't have a monolithic national approach to this, and the guidance makes clear that when developing or refreshing school guidance, there is a need for schools to look at a range of individual circumstances that might apply, and the member has given a range of different examples of those, and I know from my previous experience in the classroom there may be a need for some young people to have that contact, the need to monitor medication, the need for young carers, for example, to remain in touch with family members for their care, and also that in some cases mobile phones might be a source of support for some pupils with additional support needs. Those matters will, of course, be known to school communities and do need a tailored response. That's why I think it's hugely important that we trust our head teachers to get the implementation of this policy right, and that might look different in different schools, which is exactly why the points the member has raised today in relation to pupils and their needs is so important.
Ros McCall to be followed by Claire Hawhey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I note the Scottish Government has given support for whole school bans by empowering head teachers to take the steps that they consider appropriate. And I entirely agree with the statement that head teachers know their schools best. So can the Cabinet Secretary explain why the Scottish Government is so reluctant to give head teachers even greater autonomy so they can take whatever steps they believe is required to not only improve behaviour, but to raise attainment?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think the member raises an important point, and I also should pay tribute, Presiding Officer, to the member's interest on this issue. We've met on this, and she's written to me and corresponded on a number of occasions, particularly in relation to challenges in our own region. I think in terms of headteachers' autonomy, we've always pursued, as a government, a policy approach that seeks to empower the teaching profession, but particularly headteachers in Scotland schools. And one of the ways in which we've been able to exemplify that, of course, is through the funding of the Scottish Attainment Challenge, which flows directly to headteachers and empowers them to take decisions about additional funding in their schools and where that's best placed. So I think that's evidence of us trusting Scotland's head teachers in practice. I think more broadly to the member's suggestion about empowering them further, I am amenable to that. Of course, I need to work with COSLA, recognising their responsibilities, but I am amenable to that because I do trust our head teachers. And I think post-pandemic, we perhaps need to revisit that empowerment agenda, one on which I think we probably both agree.
Mr. Hawhey, to be followed by Martin Whitfield.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As referenced in her statement last month, the Cabinet Secretary visited Stonelaw High in my Rutherglen constituency, where they have developed their new mobile phone policy following a process of engagement and discussion with young people. Would you agree with me that similar approaches will be key to ensuring young people feel a shared ownership of their school's policy?
Cabinet Secretary.
I just put on the record, Presiding Officer, given that Stonelaw High School is in Clairhawhey's constituency, that it is an outstanding school with an outstanding head teacher and some outstanding young people. And I was delighted to meet with them 2 weeks ago to launch the mobile phone guidance, but also really importantly to talk to them about their experiences of how they've been engaged in policy development and how they felt ownership over it, not that it was something being done to them, which I think is hugely important. Stonelaw High School, of course, gives us an example of how that engagement through the curriculum has really generated an understanding of the impact of phones on learning, and that has really helped to build cooperation with the policy, not just with young people, but also with their parents and the wider community. And I know from initial feedback from pupils, but also from staff, that it's working and that young people and staff alike feel an ownership over the policy itself. It's certainly an example I would support other schools in perhaps following.
Martin Whitfield, to be followed by Rona Mackay.
I'm very grateful, Presiding Officer. The Government published the Education Outcome for Looked After Children 22-23 report. This shows that care-experienced pupils face significant challenges in achieving academic success compared to their peers. These are some of the young people who are most at risk in the environment that today's statement deals with. So can the Cabinet Secretary confirm the Government have details of the risk profile of this group? And how will these young people feed into the guidance? And how will they be included as looked after children, which is their right when this guidance is created?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for his question. He raises a hugely important point. Of course, the risk profile would be something that was owned by the local authority, not by central government, who would have the data on their individual pupils, their cohort, and they would know and understand which of their pupils were care experienced. I would expect head teachers and schools then to consider that in the application of the policy, which is why I think to one of the previous members' questions, I would expect head teachers to work with their cohort on that risk profile and to address and support accordingly pupils who may need access to a mobile phone throughout the school day. But he does raise an important point, and it is worthwhile reminding the Chamber additionally that through the Scottish Attainment Challenge there is a specific funding stream which supports looked after children and care experienced young people, and through, for example, mechanisms such as the Virtual Head Teachers Network, we've been able to support care experienced young people and get them back into school where perhaps in the past they may have not been able to engage for a variety of different reasons. So we will always work with local authorities to that end. I've set out some of the examples at national level, but in terms of the risk profile, the data set does belong to local authorities and the legislation sets out the statutory responsibility does rest with them.
Rona Mackay, to be followed by Ross Greer.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Digital technology can provide another platform for bullying, harassment and abuse, and it's vital we keep working to make sure staff and pupils are safe. Can the Cabinet Secretary speak to how, alongside the Equally Safe in Schools programme, the guidance feeds into the promotion of positive relationships and anti-bullying policies?
Cabinet Secretary.
For her question, I think in terms of developing positive relationships, it's really fundamental that we recall that the type of behaviour and relationships approaches that are probably used in Scotland schools now are not those which most members in this chamber would have experienced 20 plus years ago. So we've moved away from what I would argue was a relatively punitive approach to behaviour previously to one which is much more supportive. And undoubtedly, throughout the course of the past year, we've heard in the chamber examples of where that has created tension. I think the National Action Plan is really important in setting out expectations around about behaviour, but also expectations in terms of where we go next. So to Mr Kerr's point in relation to consequences, in relation to recording and monitoring, all of this needs to be developed in line with the teaching profession, but also in line with our pupils and our young people as well, with their interests at heart.
Scrier to be followed by George Adam.
Thank you. The Cabinet Secretary knows I try not to be cynical, but I'm struggling to understand the purpose of this mobile phone guidance. It's 10 pages that could be summarised in a single line. You, schools, have the same power to restrict mobile phones that you've always had. Given the Cabinet Secretary is well aware of the quite rightful cynicism that so many teachers feel about huge amounts of guidance being produced by government and by Education Scotland, and little, if anything, ever actually changing, could she tell me what the additional value of this guidance is when nothing has actually changed in terms of what schools can or cannot do?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I note Mr Greer's cynicism, and he will know, as a former secondary teacher, I share it generally. However, and I also should say that he received a small clap from Liam Kerr when he made that point. I'm not sure if he was... Oh, apologies. But I think to the substance, this is not another example of guidance that's not going to have an impact, because it's a plan, it's a 3-year plan, and it will be monitored, and that's quite different perhaps from other guidance that has published previously. It will be monitored, it will be published, and that will be shared, of course, with the Education Committee, who I know are taking a very keen interest in this. And the final point I would make is this advice and guidance hasn't come from thin air. It has come at the behest of the profession, who asked me as Cabinet Secretary for a clearer direction on behaviour, who were very clear that things had changed post-pandemic, and they were asking for that clear guidance from central government on expectations around about behaviour and relationships. I think we've responded to that call through the National Action Plan. As I intimated in my statement, this is not the end of the road. It's part of a process. I've set out a range of measures we have already taken in the past year, but the Action Plan will report on every year for the next 3 years, and I think that will be the marker of progress.
George Adam to be followed by Willie Rennie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm supportive of these moves, and please correct me if I'm oversimplifying this, Cabinet Secretary, but is it not the case that the most important aspect of this is that head teachers know their schools best, and empowering teachers to take these steps the best fit for their learning environments is surely the correct approach to take? And can the Cabinet Secretary provide examples of how the latest guidance will support schools to make the best choices for their pupils?
Well, I agree with Mr Adam, and I think I've mentioned this previously. Fundamentally, the guidance sets out our expectation that as a government we trust Scotland's head teachers to deliver improved behaviour and relationships in our classrooms, and I think the guidance goes some way to supporting that. It also recognises and respects the role of head teachers, and that perhaps contrasts with the approach that has been taken in other parts of the UK where the government has decided on a national ban. I think it's far better in education to work with the professionals we entrust who work in our classrooms on a daily basis. And I've been clear that the decision on whether or not to introduce bans on mobile phones is entirely one for head teachers. But of course, if they should choose to do so, they will have my full support. The member asked about an example, and of course, I've spoken at length today regarding Stonelaw High School's approach. That approach has only been possible because of the leadership taken by the head teacher in that school to support her staff, to support her young people, and to engage with the wider community. It's an example of good practice, and of course other head teachers, I'm sure, will take their own approaches to this, but the fundamental point is this: the Scottish Government trusts Scotland's head teachers to enact a ban should they see fit.
Willie Rennie to be followed by Sue Webber.
I want to give credit to the Cabinet Secretary for the focus that she's given on the behaviour issues. I think she gets the problem. And it's good to have a new action plan, but I can't fundamentally see what's new. We've got lots of guidance, lots of documents, lots of action plans. It's going to be monitored, but I'm not sure exactly what is going to be monitored. What fundamentally has changed? Because there's lots of teachers I've spoken to, and they're completely oblivious to this guidance. They've not read the action plan, they've not seen it. So can the Cabinet Secretary take the opportunity now to set out concisely what's different?
Cabinet Secretary.
Mr Rennie, for his question, he asked what is going to be monitored, and of course The action plan is going to be monitored over the course of the next year. But let me give an example of some of the things that are in the action plan. So, for example, one of the points that we've discussed at length relates to consequences. There are a range of different measures you can take in relation to consequences in school. And, in fact, Mr Rennie and I and others discussed this very recently. It's important that the action plan identifies what acceptable consequences look like. That will be a clear-cut example of something that's different. It's not something that government has specified before. The other ask that came to government from the profession and from parents and from young people was a definition of violence. I think we perhaps discussed this previously too. The action plan will set that out. That's never been set out by government before. I think it is important. The further work I think I talked to related to the work that Education Scotland's undertaken, that published on Friday in relation to S4 leaver data, I think that's really important too, and on attendance more generally, where we know there are real challenges post-pandemic, particularly in relation to certain year groups. But the action plan itself is going to be monitored by Sagribus, not just by central government. We will be held to account by the actions in that plan. And of course, the action plan has been published. I'm sorry to hear that Mr Rennie's constituents haven't engaged with it, but I'm sure as a constituency MSP, he could help to furnish them with a copy of the action plan and to share it widely, because it's hugely important that the profession is engaged with this. And of course, the action plan itself came from the Secretary. They were part of creating it in co-production with Scottish Government and with Scotland's teaching unions.
Sue Webber, to be followed by Ruth McGuire.
Thank you. Leadership is about taking bold and courageous decisions, Cabinet Secretary. Alongside teaching groups and experts like Lindsay Patterson, I've been calling on a ban on mobile phones in classrooms for quite some time now. Can you confirm today that the approach in your action plan will empower our schools and head teachers to take the necessary action to do this, or are we, in the words of Lindsay Patterson, leaving it up to schools to argue out with resentful adolescents and stroppy parents?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, it will empower head teachers to undertake a mobile phone ban. Many schools already have one. I actually read, I think, a piece in one of the newspapers in relation to Mr Patterson's views on this. I'm slightly concerned that he maybe doesn't understand the limitations on my powers as Cabinet Secretary. I cannot enforce a national ban. I do not have that power. However, local authorities do, who run our schools. That's why I trust Scotland's head teachers to get it right in their schools. And actually, I support Scotland's head teachers in taking the right decisions for the young people in their care. I'm not sure if Mr Patterson disagrees with that statement, but I don't.
And Ruth McGuire.
Presiding Officer, the Cabinet Secretary mentions in her statement the broad impact that increased access to smartphones, screens and social media is having on young people in terms of mental health, addiction and sleep deprivation. Digital technology and social media has provided an anonymous platform for unacceptable conduct that might not normally happen face-to-face. And obviously that's a problem for wider society and not just about young people. But that said, can the Cabinet Secretary say more about how the guidance will help schools support good, healthy behaviour online?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for her question. I think she raises a really important point. I'm sure colleagues in the Chamber will engage with teachers in their own constituency and parents and carers, and they will recognise some of the challenges Ms McGuire has outlined in relation to behaviour online. The guidance makes clear that unacceptable behaviour, whether that's online or not, is unacceptable. The playground, whether that be in the classroom or anywhere else, there is a limitation though to where schools can act in that regard, and that's why having really strong home link relationships is hugely important. It's also why the development of a behaviour action plan includes having those strong parental links. Having high expectations for respectful and responsible conduct should also be rooted within a school's existing positive relationships and behaviour policies. But more broadly, there is an issue and a challenge around about the use of social media and behaviour online. Schools are no different in that regard. But I think there is an opportunity through the refresh guidance on acceptable behaviours, linking that to the curriculum, to consider further learning on the use of digital technologies and in relation to the internet. I know that's something schools are taking forward at the current time, and we will continue to support them in that development through the Behaviour Action Plan.
Thank you. That concludes the ministerial statement on mobile phones and behaviour and relationships in school. We move to decision time. There are no questions to be put as a result of today's business. That concludes decision time, and we will now move on to members' business. And I ask members who are leaving the chamber to do so quietly. Thank you.